The following program contains adult language, poor taste in jokes, racial slurs, political slurs, slants, and all sorts of things that if you are sensitive and have a delicate constitution, you should probably go watch Teletubbies. You were warned.
Hey kids, welcome back to Roto Talk.
Hey kids, welcome back. All right, so this is a dual video in the sense of this is kind of a how-to video to do annealing and prop shaft tubes and stuffing boxes, and it's also part of our build video. So, okay, I had a couple requests from friends of mine on the channel to go over annealing and how it works and this, that, whatever. This is scrap. We might use this, but we're not using this. This is the shaft out of our old Nintendo boat that I destroyed a couple weeks ago that we're going to be reusing. I will walk through the process. I did a whole video a long time ago on how to do this, how to cut the shaft, how to measure the shaft, how to put the drive dog on, how to put the flat spot in, all that good stuff. So, we're going to go over a couple principles here. I enjoy this part because the building's done. It's very difficult to do the video on a wooden boat build because it's just so subjective and whatever. So now we're on the hardware, shaft tubes, things like that. So these, like I said, are scrap. What annealing is, okay? I deal with metal and hot metal every day of my life because I am with what I do for a living. So I've been around this stuff for a little bit. I don't do a lot of annealing in my job, but either way. So what annealing is basically softening, we're going to put it in layman's terms, softening the metal, no matter what kind of metal it is, all right? Now, if you're talking steels, high carbides, high carbon contents, if you will, annealing is you would heat it up to, we're just going to call it a red point, and then you let it slowly cool. And that will soften that metal. If you want to harden that metal back up, you heat it up cherry red again, douse it in cold water, poof, or oil, and you will reharden it. This is a myth. Copper and brass do not get hard from quenching. Annealing is the same principle. If you want to take the hardness out of copper and brass or any soft metal, this goes for actually almost all soft metals, not all of them, but most of them. If you want to take the hardness out, you anneal it. You heat it up so it's glowing red. There is a specific temperature, but glowing red works for boats, okay? And then you can quench it. That's a myth that you can't. Or you can just let it air dry. This stuff dries so fast, cool. It cools so fast that you don't really need to, you know, quench it. But if you quench this, it's still going to be soft. It's a myth. Annealing soft metals, you cannot reharden them by quenching them. How you reharden any type of metal that's soft, let me show you something, is you have to do what's called working it. The only way to bring this, see my little anvil? This is what I straighten prop shafts out with when I hit things. The only way to bring the hardness back to this is to work it, what they call working it. So you could put a mandrel inside here and start beating on it with a hammer or my favorite little teeny tiny ball peen. Cute. And if I were to literally flatten this and beat it and beat it and beat it and smash it, that's called working the metal. That will bring the hardness back into soft metals. That goes for gold. That goes for brass, copper, many other alloys. You can quench this if you want to, if you're in that big of a hurry. Don't be. Just let it cool by room temperature. It's not a big deal. So there's a myth busted, if you will, about annealing. So the reason we want to anneal any type of metal is to, you know, take the hardness out of it because we want to be able to bend it without it kinking. If I try to bend this, now this is, knowing me, probably already annealed. You see that crease right there it just did? That's because it's too hard. And this is actually probably even annealed a little bit. Now, even annealing it is not going to let you, it's not going to let you bend it in a circle without kinking. Okay. But it's going to let you put gradual bends in without getting this shoulder or that armpit in there. Okay. So we're going to, I'm going to show you that, and I'm going to prove that you can quench it and it will work as soon as I get something ready.
All right. Now,
that's that. Another problem, it's not really a problem because, to be honest, I do it this way all the time. I will glow it up so it looks cherry red, reasonably. It doesn't have to be cherry red. Cherry red's like about ready to melt. Just glowing. If you see it glowing, stop. You're done. However, if you're doing it in the daylight or the superficial light, like we got above here, it's actually glowing before you see it. It's actually better to anneal in the dark. It really is, okay? So what we're going to do, so we could just do this, which is still, it's actually still too bright in here, but it's better. And as soon as you start seeing that glow, that's good enough. Then you let that cool off, and it's annealed. Now you can bend it. The reason we do this in a boat is, you can see before I bent this, it was kind of like, you can't really straighten it now, but anyway, you get the idea. This was going up to the engine. That's why you want to anneal it. I anneal my shafts in most boats in two places, unless it's a mono, because monos stop here, and then the stinger goes, and the stinger is what moves. But when it comes to anything with a bracket on the back or a strut, like hydroplanes, riggers, cracker box, flat bottom cracker boxes, things like that, I will anneal it like, hang on a minute. This is our strut coming out of the back of the cracker, okay? So if we're sitting on the left-hand side of the boat, boat's facing down, okay? You know, normal. We're looking at it right side up. This is where your shaft's going. This is where your propeller's at, okay? Hang on. Sorry, smoking hot wife interruption. So, like I said, it's a nasty, snowy, cold-ass Saturday afternoon, and I got nothing better to do than to bug you guys with this video. So, dang it. Hang on. Okay, now, so here's where we're at. This is where we left off. This is going into the engine. There's a bee in here. Good luck with you. And this is the boat, bottom, the strut coming out, and this is your, I'm not going to get that in there now, obviously. This is your prop shaft. Okay? So what I will do is I anneal it where it goes, it bends up to the engine. You want to make that as gradual as possible. You do not want tight turns with a flex shaft. You want to keep it as straight as you possibly can. So if that means decreasing the engine more, if you can, your angle, we'll get to that when we go into the boat. But you don't want real sharp, like 90 degrees. That's, you ain't drilling for oil, kids. This ain't Texas, okay? So I'll anneal it right here. So where this is coming through, in the case of the cracker, there's a bracket. There's a supporting bracket. We're going to anneal it right behind that bracket, probably. We don't want to anneal it right at the end, because that's going to make it soft, okay? And that's, you don't want that to flare out and get nasty. You only want to anneal it, if possible, around where you're going to bend. So like right around here. And then I will usually put an annealment, if that's a word. You can see this goes in. Let's take a marker. This is all the way in the strut. This strut from Zip Kits that we use on the cracker A-box. Okay. Goes in that far. So I will usually anneal right about here. Okay. Now, this is scrap, so we're just going to wing it. I don't want my annealment to go past this, or my annealing process to go past this, because I don't want it soft there. I want it nice and rigid. But if we're going to be angling this strut bracket up and down, I want this to be able to flex. Does that make sense? Because when you get down to the water and you make everything parallel and square and straight and pretty, it's like, all right, let's go run our boat. And then it's all running wet as hell. I mean, the bow is plowing in and you're going to have to adjust this. It makes it very difficult to, from a geometric standpoint, to bend this if it's not annealed right here. Okay, and you're not talking to, you just anneal it. You don't actually bend it, okay? This part's just annealed. This part you'll bend. But you want this annealed so when you are down at the water and you're setting up your boat, it makes it easier to flex. Because if I try to bend this right now, it's going to kink. And you're going to get that number. And then you're going to get a bind in your shaft. Don't want a bind in your shaft. And then you're going to rip. You're going to cause a lot of friction in your shaft. It's going to heat up. It's going to break. And that's a bad day at the zoo because then your prop's going to fall off. You can put all the little prop savers on there you want, but if your shaft breaks back here, we'll talk about prop savers later. So let's go ahead and anneal this just for demonstration purposes. So this is a MAP gas cylinder. MAP gas is like similar to propane. It's between propane and acetylene. It's hotter than propane, but not nearly as hot as acetylene, obviously. This is not MAP gas. This is propane gas. I refill my own bottles. Much cheaper to refill these bottles. You know, buy yourself a grill, propane grill cylinder, a big one. Buy the fitting that you can refill these with, and you can refill them for about $1, or you can buy a new cylinder for 10. So that's what I do. So what we're going to do is, first thing we're going to do is we're going to anneal it right here, and we're going to let it air dry. Okay. There we go. I'm going to turn off the lights. Why not? Try not to cook the camera. And you just do a nice rotation. Slow. It does not take long to do this. We're going to move the camera over here. A little darker. Ooh, I can smell the grease burning out of there. Okay. Just rotate it. You might want to use a glove. Now, you see it turning? It's glowing. That's fine. Let it cool. Yoink. All right. Now, what I have done before, now, if the lights were on, you'd see that glowing much later. Is it really that big of a deal? No. You don't want to make it glow to the point where it's melting. That would be bad. But to truly do a real annealing job, you want to do it with the lights off, because you're going to see that glow much sooner. Okay. Now what you can do is you can take sandpaper, which we will be doing when we glue in the shaft, but or on your wire wheel on your bench, and you can get that oxidation or heat deprivation off there, and it'll look nice and shiny again if that's your thing. Now, this is fairly hot, so we're going to let that one cool, and we're going to call this A with an air cooled, just so we know. I'm going to grab another piece of scrap. Hang on. Another piece of scrap tubing. I have tons of this shit. Now what we're going to do is we're going to quench it. We're going to let them both cool off, and we're going to see if they bend the same. Hang on. Okay, so we're going to anneal it pretty much the same way. Let's mark it. I don't know how well the camera's picking this up in the dark. That's okay. Same method. Actually, I'm going to turn the light now. We're going to quench it. All right. See how much faster that went? Now, or not faster, but if the lights were on, you'd just now probably be seeing it. Still nice and hot. Okay. Right between those lines. I should be able to pick this up. That's 100 degree water in there with Dawn soap. That's all it is. Now, we quenched this with annealing soft tubing. You should be able to bend this without it kinking. Look, it does. Now, like I said, even with annealing, you can't do a 90. It's still going to, you're going to have to put an arbor in there. If you know anything about bending pipe, you have to put an arbor in there or fill this full of sand. I did a video on that once too, where you can fill this full of sand and bend it, and it'll you have to have something holding the pressure of those inner walls. But when you want to bend a shaft after you anneal it, put your thumb in there and just go slow. Okay? Look at that. No kink. Perfect. Now, here's the one we let air dry. Nice and cool. Exact same. Okay? Put your thumbs right on the ends of the annealing. It helps. And you shouldn't feel much resistance. I mean, you're going to have some. You're going into a bend. Okay. So there, that myth is busted. I personally let them air dry. I really do. I don't quench them. I'm not in that big of a hurry. It saves you about 15 seconds. Copper, aluminum, brass heat up very fast, but they also dissipate heat very fast. That's why you see aluminum heat sinks. And in welding, you see copper backing on weld fixtures and things like that. If you're from my world, you're robotic welding, because they dissipate the heat. If you're getting burned through on a weld, robotic welding or even hand welding, and you copper back that fixture that's holding your part, it will help dissipate that heat like a heat sink. These things cool off fast. Don't quench them. But it just always bugs me. People are always, oh, let it go to room temperature. Let it go to room temperature. Yeah. All right. So now, come on. There we go. We're going to really heat this up now. We're doing it in the daylight. Well, fake light. Now, you'll remember just a minute ago, it was glowing by now. Pretty close to it. I didn't time it. Now I'm starting to see a glow. And if you want to anneal a large surface, go in nice long strokes. It's getting hot, kind of hot. Now I'm going to quench it. Give me a second. The only reason I'm quenching it is because I don't want to waste a ton of time on this. Okay. So use your thumbs because you still have to support it. You can't just, you know. And you can kind of work it with your thumbs. Okay. Now that's way too extreme. You would never want to run a boat prop through that. That would be a shaft. You're not going to last long. But see how smooth that is? Reasonably smooth. Now if I try to do an area that's not annealed like that. See that? That's what annealing does. So the only way to bring that back, you can't do it with a shaft tube. The only way you possibly could bring hardness back to this, possibly, is if you sent something through there that was very, very hard, like a steel shaft that fit perfect, and beat on it with a hammer to bring the hardness back. You ain't doing it otherwise. You can quench it all day. It's not bringing back the hardness. So you guys in the forums, let it air dry. If you quench it, it'll harden it. You are wrong. Study your metallurgy. Okay. So, now, the next bit. So, like I said, I do a little bit behind where it goes into the strut, and obviously where it goes in the engine. When we get to the boat bit of putting it in the boat, I'll show you how to do that. Now, you've heard terminologies maybe in the forums or wherever. There's stuffing box, stuffing box. What the hell's a stuffing box? I remember when I first started into boats many moons ago, I'm like, a stuffing box? What the fuck is that? That's what this is. This is an oversized tube of your quarter-inch shaft tube, okay? So, and I'll put the measurements up there. But see how that slides in, okay? To make it a little bit easier on the eyes, so it's not an eye chart. You guys can probably see that line, okay? This is sliding in. Okay, this would be the part glued into your boat. This is the part that is going, here's the brace, here's the engine, here's your brace. This is going into the brace. Run 80 grit sandpaper around this, epoxied into that brace, and then obviously there's a hole in the bottom of the boat. Same principle, I'll show you how to do all that, but we're going to sand it there too so it's a nice gripping surface. This is the part that will be annealed as well. Sometimes, depends on the angles. And this is forever in the boat. That makes your prop shaft going through the boat removable. And you'd have to anneal it here and again here if you want to. And then all you do is slide it in there. And if you hit something in the water or you drop your boat, whatever the case may be, and you get a bend in this, uh-oh, that's a problem. Got to get your shaft out. Then you can just literally pull this out, cut yourself a new shaft tube, put this dude back in, put your new shaft tube in, and you're ready to rock and roll. That's it. That's what a stuffing tube box, whatever you want to call it, is. Okay. 9 times out of 10, what you'll want to do is you'll want to take some sandpaper, light sandpaper, like 220, get this varnish off, get the varnish off this, varnish meaning oxidation, okay, wire wheel, whatever you want to do, And once you fit this into your boat, heat this up with a soldering iron, put some flux on there, put one drop of solder if you want to. That will keep your shaft from rotating from torsion. Okay. Some boats I do, some boats I don't. It just depends. And then when you want to change your shaft tube, you don't want to get too hot because then you'll actually pipe weld it and that would be bad. Then when you're if you need to replace your shaft tube, you can just unsolder it. I'm not sure what we'll do. Now, some of my boats have this method, and some of them are straight shaft, meaning there's no stuffing box to fit into. Cracker boxes, I'm going to be honest with you, I'm really hard on them. Those are my daily runners. I like to throw them in the lake to chase geese. I do stupid things with them because it didn't take me a ton of money to build the hull. It didn't take me a ton of time to build the hull. And it's not like a backlash, a Blazer Marine backlash, or you know, some boat that really took me a long time to build. You know, I usually build new crackers a couple a year because either I just get tired of the old one and I burn it and I build a new one. They're economical, they're cheap. So I don't usually have a cracker long enough life expectancy to need to change the shaft. Honestly, I mean, now my hydroplanes all have something like this. My fiberglass hulls all have something like this, especially fiberglass. You always use an oversized tube or a stuffing box to put your shaft in. Always a wood cracker or something that I just like to build. And I get tired of, oh, I don't want a Nintendo. I want to build a Sega boat now. Okay, fine. And, you know, I don't do this. I just make my shaft tube and glue it in. It's whatever you want to do. On this particular boat, I have not decided what I'm going to do yet. I'm probably just going to do the shaft itself, but I will walk through the method of putting in that tube. So that's really about it for annealing. I don't think there's anything else. So if you are using one of these, and if you plan on, this is your baby, you know, cracker boxes are awesome boats. Keep it for 30 years if you can. That's great. This is your baby, and you want to put one of these in there so you can pull this in and out. You got to remember, the reason people solder these in is because this just slides into the strut. There's no set screw. There's no nothing. If you have a reasonably straight shot from your strut to the stuffing box, it's going to rotate on you. And that could be bad. You don't want that. Or if you have a slight bend in it, that bend will rotate and it'll be going the wrong way. Okay, so that's why you solder these. You don't have to. It just depends on the setup. I do recommend you do in most cases if you use one of these. So that's really it for annealing. We're going to go ahead and do one and show you how to put the hole in the bottom of the boat, glue it in, all that good stuff. Next video. Dry side up.